Yes, so I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to tell you something about MR spectroscopy, or MRS, and MR spectroscopic imaging, or MRSI. When I first got the invitation, I was really excited, but then when I started to think a little bit more, MRS and MRSI are really not new techniques. They have been around since the day of MRI. Right, the first two papers on MRI from Lauterbur and Mansfield were in 73, and the similar papers on in vivo MRS are 1 year later. So then I started to think, well, MRS is not that well known in the field. So I think it can still be transformative for people who don't know what MRS can do and have an opportunity to use it. So the first half of this presentation is going to be about summarizing what the current state of MRS is and what you can do with it. And then I'll hope to end with giving you a long-term view of what I think should happen in the next 10 years. So just to get some definitions out of the way, when we talk about MRI or MR imaging, we're looking at the spatial distribution of water, which is about 40 molar worth of signal. And we're looking at water and its properties. The frequencies that we detect with NMR are spatially dependent so that we can make it into an image. The resolution of MRI is typically about 1 microliter, and you can acquire that in seconds to minutes. And if you really push it, you can go about an order of magnitude better on either one of them. MR spectroscopy is basically looking at all other chemicals, not water. And so they are typically in the millimolar range. You acquire them from a single volume in space, and the frequencies that you detect are chemical specific, also referred to as chemical shifts. The spatial resolution for proton MRS is about 1 mL, and you can acquire that in minutes. And if you really push this, you can go about an order of magnitude better on the spatial resolution, and the temporal resolution, you can go seconds for select compounds. MR spectroscopic imaging is a logical combination of the two, where you get images of specific metabolites at the spatial resolution of MRS. Now, what can we do with proton MRS? So this is a proton MR spectrum from brain. There's a lot of signals in there. And some of the most important ones are from the amino acid neurotransmitters, glutamate, GABA. There's also signals that relate to energy metabolism intermediates. And there's a whole bunch of other ones, antioxidants, cholines, etc. There's also a long list of metabolites that you normally don't see, but they are visible in specific pathologies or specific conditions. So what can you do with a proton MR spectrum? Well, clinically, there are many examples. This is a very obvious one, where we have a subject that has a creatine synthesis deficiency, and the creatine signal, which should be there, is completely gone. When the subject then undergoes creatine supplementation, you can see that over time, the creatine signal goes up. So a very clear-cut clinical example of the use of MRS. A more subtle example is perhaps given by Manji et al., where they studied metabolic changes during visual activation. So you get a proton spectrum before and during the activation, and then the difference will tell you the signals, the metabolites, that change in concentration. And lactate and glutamate are the most prominent ones. You can also do spectroscopic imaging. In this particular example, we have a patient with a brain tumor. In spectroscopic imaging, you get a spectrum from every 1 mL volume. So every location has a spectrum like this. You can quantify the NAA signal and then display that as an image. And you can do the same thing for choline and creatine, etc. And then you can see in this case, the NAA has clearly decreased at this location. Now, you're not limited to just proton MRS. You can also do phosphorus MRS. This is a typical phosphorus MR spectrum, looking at ATP, phosphocreatine, and other information you can get is related to the intra and extracellular pH based on the shift of this peak, the inorganic phosphate. You can also get fluxes through the creatine kinase system or ATP synthesis. And the bunch of peaks right over there are related to the redox potential. Now, this can also be done in 3D. This is a recent paper where they basically spatially mapped the pH. And you can see this is again in a brain tumor patient, that where the tumor is, the pH is also different. Now, these flux measurements are also very important, and you can measure them with a so-called saturation transfer experiment. but they are measuring rates that are relatively fast. If you want to measure slower rates, you can use carbon 13 MR spectroscopy. The normal carbon, carbon 12, doesn't have a nuclear spin, so it doesn't give you any signal, but carbon 13 does. So what you can do is you can purchase glucose that is enriched with carbon 13 and then give that glucose to the subject. The glucose is metabolized as if it was normal glucose, and it can undergo glycolysis, it can enter the TCA cycle, the labeled glutamate then can undergo neurotransmission, etc. The carbon 13 label is basically transferred from molecule to molecule, and in every molecule it has a different frequency. So if you acquire a carbon 13 spectrum, you get all of these different frequencies corresponding to these different molecules. Now, you can also acquire this dynamically over time. So if we look at the biggest signal, which is from glutamate, the glutamate goes from zero and it labels up over time. Now, if you now analyze this curve, you can tell something about how fast the TCA cycle is operating. Similarly, the glutamine is the lower curve, is also labeling over time. It tells you something about the neuron transmitter cycle rate. Now, this is a great research tool, but the sensitivity of carbon 13 typically limited to relatively large volume. So imaging is typically not an option. Recently at Yale, but also the group in Minnesota, have shown that deuterium NMR is a very viable and sensitive alternative to carbon 13 NMR. If you get a deuterium NMR spectrum from brain, you typically just get your natural abundant water signal. If you now give the subject deuterated glucose, then you see after some time that the metabolic products, glutamate and lactate, are being formed, very similar to the carbon 13 experiment. But the difference is that this experiment, this spectrum was acquired in only 1 minute. So it is really good signal to noise, and that then really opens up the possibility to acquire images. So that's what we did a few years ago. This is data on a patient with an aggressive brain tumor. These are the clinical images of this patient, and you can see there is all things wrong with this brain on this side. And metabolically, you can also see a very big difference between where the tumor is versus normal tissue. And why is that? Well, if we look at a spectrum from the normal hemisphere, you can see that in addition to the water and the glucose, you have a high glutamate and low lactate. Whereas in the tumor tissue, we have very low glutamate and very high lactate. So if you look at the ratio of lactate over glutamate, you're going to get a high contrast to noise in the tumor compared to normal brain. So this is kind of like the current state of where we are with MRS. Of course, it could do a lot more, but this is what I wanted to summarize. So where do we go with this in the next 10 years? Well, this is a summary modified from a recent paper from Andrew Maudsley. It is basically a consensus statement on MRSI. And basically what they are saying is that if you're interested in NAA, choline, and creatine, and you acquire the signal from a limited region, you get really good, robust data. If you include more metabolites, or if you try to acquire the signal from larger areas in the brain, you're going to get technical problems related to incomplete lipid suppression, incomplete water suppression, magnetic field inhomogeneity, and ultimately when you start to look at the low concentration metabolites, the SNR will also be an issue. So ideally, all of these boxes will be in the green. It would be robust to acquire this kind of data. The reality is that we're not there yet. And so I think in the next decade, we hope to see a push where we can really start to look at the interesting metabolites like glutamate and GABA across entire slices or across the entire human brain. Now, there are already a lot of hardware solutions to actually address these technical problems. Magnetic field homogeneity affects every aspect of MR, and especially MR spectroscopy. At Yale, about a decade ago, we described multi-coil shimming. The MGH group took that concept and basically expanded upon that. And there are also higher order spherical harmonic shim inserts that give really good homogeneity. So any of these three techniques can give you a magnetic field homogeneity that is near perfect, so that it doesn't have to be a problem anymore. Similarly, for lipid suppression, There are a number of techniques available for excellent limit suppression. At Yale, we have focused on the so-called eclipse technique, where we select an elliptical volume with pulsed second order fields. So this is a dedicated second order gradient insert. If you don't have current in the coil, you can see everything of the brain and of the head. Put some current in, you basically strip an elliptical ROI away from the brain, and you have really, really good lipid suppression. Now, unfortunately, all of these techniques are only available right now in a research environment. And so I hope in the next decade that this is going to be expanded upon for more research sites and ultimately also in the clinic. Another way to kind of emphasize MRS a bit more is to interleave it with MRI. So this is a standard flare MR image, so fluid attenuated inversion recovery. It's a standard clinical scan, takes about 7 minutes for a whole brain coverage. But like most MR imaging sequences, the flare method has a lot of delays intrinsic to the method. What you can do is, during those delays, acquire signal from a different nucleus. Now, we've been doing that. We've been combining that with the deuterium metabolic imaging. And so basically, we're going to get deuterium signal in addition to the flare MRI. And most importantly, the total scan time is exactly the same because we are using the delays that are already present in the sequence. Now, interleaved acquisitions have been around for decades, but it really starts to come into focus now. There are a number of papers, including this one from a New York group, where they've done proton MR imaging and then interleaved with sodium MRI. And I think there's a lot of applications to get ex nuclei, non-proton MRS combined with MRI. Yeah, how about in research? I think we're gonna see an increasing level of metabolic detail. So earlier I talked about a functional MR spectroscopy looking at lactate and glutamate. This is gonna be tuned down to look at lower concentration metabolites, including GABA. And this paper has now shown changes in GABA during visual activation or deactivation in the PCC area. The Minnesota group has done very nice work looking at the redox potential, NADH over NAD plus, as a function of age, and it decreases. Very clear neuroscience application. And what always amazes me about spectroscopy is that you can get really direct answers if you have the right question. But one question that we had a few years ago is, do tumors utilize beta hydroxybutyrate, or BHB? This is a ketone body, and this is a relevant question because people are using ketogenic diet to treat brain tumors. Now, if you want to answer this question, you just buy carbon 13 labeled BHB and give it to an animal or a human subject with a brain tumor. And if you see the formation of C13 labeled glutamate, then you know that the BHB has been taken up by the tumor and has been metabolized by the tumor. I think we're going to see a good push also is to maximize the amount of information you get from spectra. This is some data from the Israel group, similar data from the Zurich group, and Jun Chen at NIH is doing similar work as well. Basically acquiring a lot of data from different echo times and different repetition times, and then model everything together to get metabolite concentrations, T1 relaxation, T2 relaxation, and basically any parameter that the experiment is sensitive to. We're already seeing a big push to get MRSI higher spatial resolution. And of course, deep learning is definitely up and coming. And so the combination of the two makes a lot of sense. So there's already a number of papers that basically show that with deep learning, you can get higher resolution and higher sensitivity MR spectroscopic images. We've also done recently our own work utilizing this for deuterium metabolic imaging. If you do conventional processing, you have noisy maps. If you use deep learning, then the maps get much more precise. Both of these methods use spatial priors from the MR image. And I think over the next decade, we will see what are the boundaries. How far can you push this technology that it still makes sense? And if you push it too far, it becomes nonsensical. So that is hopefully where this is going. So in summary, I hope I've been able to show you that MRS and MRSI are very powerful, but generally lesser known variants of MR imaging. They don't have the sensitivity and spatial resolution, primarily because of the lower concentrations, but they really make up for that by increased chemical information. Clinically, I think MRS can provide a lot of insight that MRI cannot provide you, and I think it really needs to have a second chance. Especially for non-proton nuclei or ex-nuclei, there is a great opportunity to use interleave MR imaging with the acquisition of ex-nuclei data, and you essentially got to get that data for free because the experiment doesn't take any longer. Proton MRSI is already working well, but it needs to work even better. It needs to become more robust and automated, similar to MRI. MRI always works. MRSI should always work. There are hardware solutions already available, but they just need to be disseminated better. Finally, in neuroscience research, MRSI is a unique tool to get really direct answers if you have the right questions. And really, the imagination is the ultimate limit here. Finally, I would like to thank my colleagues at Yale. This is the group working on DMI, led by Henk de Feiter. The engineering team is working on the Eclipse spatial localization method. The faculty at Yale is always there to give great advice. Of course, the funding, especially NIH, is essential for our work. And recently, we put up a DMI website for anyone who's interested in that new technology. Finally, I'd like to thank you for your attention.